بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. Before we get into the discussion of the surah, it is really important to remind ourselves what is really the context. I mean the context at what time this surah was revealed, taking really the chronology, if you like, of the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and really that coincides with the premise that we based our discussion on from the beginning, is that like we want really to answer a specific question. What were really the early messages of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Okay, as can be extracted from the verses that were revealed to him in a chronological way. Okay, and so we are discussing the chapters of the last para, 30th para of Quran, but we ordered them according to the chronology of revelation. And in that way, we can really be more capable of answering really that question. And historians wanted really like to go beyond the dividing the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam into the Meccan period versus really the Medina period, which is really a global way of looking at his really biography and his experience during the last like 20 to 23 really years, which is the time when he received the message and the revelation of Quran took really that time. But even if we go deeper in the dissection, if you like, of that history or that biography, we can really divide even the Meccan period into different really stages. And that will help us by putting certain really landmarks, because they will help us to see the changes. This is a phase, this is a different phase that dictates different challenges, or came with different challenges that dictate different really responses. And if you remember, we mentioned this before, that like, for example, today, I mean, the surah, according to our order, it is at number 27. But really around the time of the revelation of the 22nd, 23rd surah, according to this chronology, another surah was revealed but does not belong to the 30th para. It's called Surah An-Najm. And that surah, it was for the first time that the idols that were worshipped in Arabia, in Mecca and its surroundings, okay, were directly mentioned. Before that, there was really no mention about, it was not like a direct, if you like, challenge to the system itself. They were talking about things that even the system did not feel the challenge about it, like, because all the things in that message was really good, talking about being good to your neighbor, to the needy, to the poor, to the, you see, I mean, at the beginning they did not feel, I mean, the challenge. But now when Quran start really talking about really the underpinning of these problems, the underlying problems, they start to feel that the system itself being challenged, they start now, they change their tone, okay? And really the experience of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam entered into a new really phase that we, as you know from reading the biography of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and what happened to his, to many of his companions in terms of threats, sometimes really killing, conspiracy to kill, you see, I mean, torture, all these things start really to happen during that period. So I just want like to remind you that now the surahs, now the chapters that you will be discussing, that they are revealed in that context. And so you can see and understand why certain experiences will be mentioned, certain ideas will be challenged, okay? Because it is timely now to mention these really and to talk about these issues. Before that, it was really as if you are giving a solution to no problem. Now you can really identify the problem and give the solutions or the answers that are compatible with these really new challenges. Now, Surah Al-Nazi'at is another surah that starts also with an oath. And again, we have seen other surahs before that start with really an oath. But what I have noticed that this genre, okay, of the oath has become more and more complicated. I mean by complicated, it's not like, remember like in the previous surahs, Quran will say, like let us say, وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَى. الشَّمْسِ, everybody knows what is the sun, okay? So it's clear. I mean, the tangible, okay? It's not like something that you need a lot like to think about and imagine. Probably about the meaning, it's a different thing. But at least you know what Quran is really talking about. Last time, things start to change. It's not like talking about like one element by itself in this universe, but putting 3, 4, 5 images together, it's like becoming really like more complicated. It's like, just to bring this closer to our comprehension, when a poet starts really talking about something in nature and reflecting about it, like a scenery, a nice valley, or idyllic picture like in a certain play. But then the poet himself or herself start really like putting more than one element together, the picture becomes really more, sometimes even obscure. Because I mean that there are so many meanings embedded in it, but you really need sometimes the poet himself or herself to explain to you what about this, but he or she leaves it, okay, for the reader to start reflecting more about it, and they make their own interpretations, okay? They may get closer or away, okay, more or less, okay, towards what the poet himself really needs to transmit and relay really to others. So my point is that today we will see even more complex type of oath. And really we want really your help. We need to really brainstorm and to see if we can and think about it as an activity, an intellectual activity, where we can together learn how to come to some form of consensus, if you like. Something that will be closer to the understanding of all of us. But in order to do that, we will definitely help, okay, in like bringing the facts to you and then to make really that mix, okay, and see if we can decipher that picture. Because yes, it will be an intellectual, really, if you like, exercise. But it doesn't mean intellectual that we won't like to bring it and like that has no connection with our life. That this is not really the idea. In fact, the more we go deeper into that, we see the connection with my daily life, because this is really the intention. Why Quran is mentioned again? If it has nothing to do with my life, if it just like to sit and enjoy a nice discussion, I don't think that is really the idea. But we need to put into it the maximum of our intellectual experience and capacity in order to get closer to what does it really mean, this oath. So as we said, let me give you a quick overview, if you like, just how, what are the topics that the surah talks about, okay? Because you can really divide the surah into four or five, if you like, paragraphs, or each one will really talk about a certain thing, and let us see how they really connect with each other, and to help us to know what is this oath is all about. Make sense to you?
Right.
Okay. So I will talk a little bit more about the oath, but let me, after the oath, Quran really bring us into a situation similar to what we have seen before in previous surahs, that this movement in this universe is coming to a halt, and it, or we are going into to see a some form of metamorphosis. There will be a change, okay, significant change, to move from this life to a different life. As if you are really, we are living in a life that is governed by a certain scheme or paradigm, and there will be a shift into the what we call the hereafter, or the day of judgment, okay, the next life, okay? Similar to what we have seen in really other surahs that we have discussed so far. And we will talk really more about that. But the new thing in this surah that we have not seen, I mean, mentioned before, is really to bring before us, although in a very brief way, the experience of a previous civilization in the days of in the Egyptian civilization, or a certain period around the time, in the time of Musa alayhi salam, and his experience with the people of Egypt, and the Pharaoh of that really historical period. And Quran will emphasize on the social diseases that afflicted that civilization. And if you like, what was the price that the people had to pay for that civilization? And Quran will really emphasize the diseases of arrogance, the disease of exploitation, the disease of going beyond the limit, the disease of oppression, by the word tagha. اذهب إلى فرعون إنه طغى. So Quran will emphasize that disease, and at, towards the end of the surah, Quran will bring us a picture from the hereafter to show us what outcomes to be expected, and based on what. And again, it will show what will be the outcome of oppression, exploitation, going beyond the limit. What is really the outcome of tagha? What they will, what the price they have to pay here, and what the price they are going to pay in the hereafter, if you like. And in between, Quran will really divert, if you like, or bring to our attention this universe and ask really a very, very important question that we can really ponder together on it, where Quran will say, أَأَنْتُمْ أَشَدُّ خَلْقًا أَمِ السَّمَاءِ. What does it really mean, أَشَدُّ خَلْقًا? Is it really our creation, was it harder than the creation of the heaven, the earth, the mountains, and everything you see in this huge? Or is it really talking about our own creation compared to the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is civilization is the result of our own creation? I'm just, again, bringing the question, all right? But they will be very helpful. And right, like now, talking about this, the beginning of the surah, which is really, the more you think about it, the more you feel that there's something deeper and deeper and deeper, the more you dig, okay? And the more you see that, oh my God, you need to dig further. Further and further down in order to make at least the connection between these different really parts really of the surah. So if you now...
Yeah, maybe I can suggest...
Yeah, please.
Because Dr. Waleed tried to... The question is here, we have the ayah 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to start with. How to relate this ayah from 1 to 5 to 6 and 7. Mm-hmm. I would suggest if you can give the meaning of the word.
Yes.
Because the idea how we can draw a picture that can relate swear with something to prove something.
Yeah.
So 1 to 5 is ayat. They are they are used to prove that 6 and 7 is going to happen.
So please read them with me, these five verses, and try to listen to the tone. Okay, and believe me, regardless if you know the language or you don't, but at least you feel there is something that will connect these, at least linguistically. Okay. والنازعات غرقا والناشطات نشطا والسابحات سبحا فالسابقات سبقا فالمدبرات أمرا. What do you see in all these really the first word? I mean each verse like is two words. Okay. نازعات ناشطات سابحات سابقات مدبرات. You are familiar with, let us say, مسلمين مسلمات مؤمنين مؤمنات. What I am talking about here, male female. Okay, so first of all these words, okay, are not nouns, they are adjectives. If we're noun, it will solve the problem. Like Al-Shams, Al-Qamar, we will know what Quran is talking about. But Quran here is talking about, okay, an attribute of something that you are going like to decipher what maybe it is. Okay, so they are, we have adjectives and they are in the feminine.
These are feminine?
Yeah. As we said, mu'minat is the like the feminine of mu'min or mu'mini or mu'minun. You see? So when you see this, the end of alif and ta, you are talking about something in the feminine. Okay? So nazi'at, nashitat, sabihat, sabiqat, mudabbirat, they are in the plural feminine adjectives. Okay? We want to know what possible nouns are given really these really adjectives. Okay? Yeah.
But it doesn't mention the word angel.
No.
No.
Right. No. We will get into that.
Wow.
Very, you see?
So how did he come to
this? Yeah.
Because they are guests.
Yeah. It's they are trying their best to see what is it. But then they will get into the problem because they don't see the connection. And so this is what we, for us, we say, oh my God, let us revisit. Okay, see how we can. So I'm trying to go into this type of analysis so that it helps also you to help so us to get into something that would really make a sense, okay, based on the structure of the surah and what are really the lessons that the surah is trying really to bring across. So, as you said, adjectives, plural, and the feminine form, and all of them, again, this is my, I mean, observation, okay, is that all of these adjectives have to do with movement.
Action.
Action being taken in different forms. However, you are initiating a movement, nazi'at, okay, or you are doing it actively, moving actively, nashitat, okay, or you are floating, or talking about something floating, swimming, navigating, going without or against minimal or no resistance, okay, sabiqat, racing, and mudabbira, executing a certain order, mudabbirati amra. So there is a lot of movement here, okay, in different forms, really, and shapes, and again, something in groups, if you like, because it is a plural. If you have questions, start asking, because that will help so to direct really the...
Nazia means, to me, like bringing something up or diving to get something.
Yes, like to initiate, if you like,
okay,
an action, if you like. And has also, more meanings, yes.
Also has also meaning of tendency.
Tendency, yeah. You have this tendency to do something.
This,
yeah. But the same word, the next word, gharqan.
Yeah.
One nazighati gharqan.
Yeah.
You are going very deep.
Deep. Right. Or, because gharqan literally, it means drowning.
Drowning, yeah.
Okay. But really, when you see someone drowning, this individual is really disappearing. This individual is overwhelmed. This individual is indulged. You see?
Panic.
It may be, yeah. I mean, associated really with that or this anxiety, okay, yeah. to execute something, to do something. Yeah. So all these meanings
also,
may come into the picture.
Also, lose his own mind. I mean, he doesn't know what's going on.
They're probably confused.
Confused.
Yeah. Yeah.
What does then, kindly, when, you know, at a time,
uh-huh,
if we can talk about the meaning and understanding.
Yeah, yeah. Well, then, the anashitas is really, again, talking about moving with actively.
Actively.
Full of energy.
Full of energy.
Full of energy with active. Maybe we can say peace of mind and knowing what he's doing.
It doesn't tell.
No, it has a different state.
Yeah. It's moving force. With full force and energy.
Okay. Nashtan.
Nashtan is really like bringing it to the extreme.
Okay.
To the maximum of the ability.
Max.
Okay. You see?
Yeah. Max.
Yeah.
What's sabiha?
Even in the Arabic language, when we say maf'ul mutlaq, which is in the absolute, free. I mean, like, you can do whatever. No constraints.
And nashitat means moving?
Moving actively.
Actively, okay. And what's sabihat is sabhan?
Sabihat from sabaha.
Okay.
To swim, to float, to navigate, to move like, because when you are moving in water, right, okay, you don't feel
in space.
Yeah, there is no much resistance. Yeah, because Quran uses it also for the stars swimming in their orbit.
What does sabhan mean?
Sabhan, again, it is the doing this swimming or floating to the maximum without really any, yeah, without really any restraint.
This one, yeah.
When I say akala, to eat, when I say akaltu aklan, means I ate as if there is no.
It's a superlative.
It's like
you are in, totally immersed in that action.
Yeah. That's why we use the term mutlaq, means like in the absolute, the maximum that you can think of.
And then what
fassabiqat? Fassabiqat means like they are like racing, moving, but there is sort the idea of racing.
Yeah, ahead.
Or you are making, yeah, because somebody will be ahead of the other when you are racing.
You are looking to be ahead of something.
Something.
Yeah.
No.
Okay. But it's all talking about doing it together, like not one individual.
And the plural, yes.
The plural.
You have to keep that in the back of our mind. Yes.
And all these actions kind of going together too. Like seems like they're trying to, you know, get to somewhere.
Which is mudabbirati amra. To execute an order. You see? Now, the point here that I think we can get into more details. Yes, please.
I have one question.
Yeah.
So, we know that this is all describing the angels, though.
No, we don't know.
So then how can somebody put in their translation about the angels if we don't know?
That's their
interpretation.
That's the
so what leads us to that interpretation? Do we refer to a group of angels by the feminine then?
Very good question, because really Muhammad Asad, rahimahullah, raised that question in his commentary, saying that if you look across Quran, never Quran used, these adjectives, or did not describe malaika in that plural feminine term.
Right.
For example, الملائكة باسطو أيديهم doesn't say باسطات أيديهم, for example. So Quran, so his point of view is that, or he rejected the idea that these are in reference to the angels, because it doesn't really fit into the whole linguistic scheme of Quran. You see sometimes how you can use this methodology to help you to see if your hypothesis is right or wrong. So he put it as a hypothesis, let us say it is meant by it, the angels. But then when he looked in the rest of Quran, he found the opposite.
And also, but Dr. Wali, is it not true in creation, everything created in pairs?
In?
Pairs.
Pairs, yes.
So there should be feminine angelic law. If they are in pair too, men.
I think on purpose also, Quran, shied away from describing the angels as having even gender. So we are not talking about male, female when it comes to this type of a creation.
And even zawjiyah, because pairs may be the translation, but zawjiyah is, it's in pairs, but when it comes to the human being level itself, dhakar wa untha, male and female. Quran is very precise when it comes to the human being. But zawjiyah, that the whole universe, you know, is based on it. Doesn't mean male, female. When you have electron, you don't see, look for the male of the electron. So, you know,
so
is zawjiyah is reflect that idea at the need for someone else to generate life or to make it possible.
Okay.
It's not female. No, in the, at the human being level, we can see as zawjiyah concretize it through male and female. But zawjiyah is universal concept.
Oh.
In the whole world is based on, because this is why as zawjiyah is by the creation itself, any creation is in need to other creation to make life possible, to continue life itself. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is not created, So he's not part of the Zawji.
No, Brother Wali, in the first ayah, it's saying also the who tear out the souls of the wicked. That's the translation. This but there's no talk about the souls of the wicked. So us who are not Arab speaking, we are looking at the.
Yes, you're right. And more than that, sister, because even the idea of angels. Didn't really reach it. We are at the beginning of the surat here.
So
what angels we are talking about who take, you know, the soul and
so
the...
So who are we referring to? What do you think?
This is what we are trying to find
out. I know.
Otherwise it will not...
No, I have to agree to now rethink the whole surah.
Yes.
I'm thinking in my mind angels and...
Yes.
Now what would I think about?
Or do you, or is this just a preface for what comes next? And do you just read this and say, okay, let me read forward to come next?
Yes.
And this is the methodology that you are trying to find.
Yeah.
Okay, what the surah is talking about, this is why I tried like to give a quick overview, what are the subjects that the surah is really touching on. And then that will help us to see the connection between this old and the rest of the surah. Otherwise, it becomes fragmented, disconnected, and will not really understand really anything.
Two things. Number one, in your, and we'll read and maybe we will understand better, but why the feminine group is mentioned in these ayahs, number one. And number two, you mentioned Surah Najm. I think it's in that surah that in those days, the Quraysh or the
Kuffar.
Can we move on to these subjects, then we will see how these questions can be answered by itself.
Those Kuffar, they had their idols, and they were, in their mind, they were the daughters of they were the angels.
Angels'
name, but they, in their mind, angels were the daughter of Allah. That's what they believe in.
And not only, they talk about them that they are the daughters of Allah, or they are really like, they gave them the feminine characterization.
Okay,
وَجَعَلُ الْمَلَائِكَةَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ إِنَاثًا. And Quran will say, أَشَهِدُوا خَلْقَهُمْ. Have they, were they present when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So the, on purpose, Quran will not really talk about them. And the, so that is enough to tell us that Quran will not be referring here to the angels. So you see, makes it, I mean, it's always, I mean, for people, they have the right to ponder and to start to reach whatever, I mean, is available to them, okay? But once you see a stronger evidence, you start changing really your ideas or your even beliefs in something like that. So again, we are here before groups, okay? And that may, okay, take really the linguistic use of the feminine form, okay? I mean, is it really like, let me suggest, okay, certain possibilities, okay? The commentators, at least, okay, they said, could this be in reference to the stars? Mm-hmm. Because the stars will be like, as if they are going to execute a certain video order.
Right.
Just recently, and it appeared in science, somebody studied really the movement of certain type of whales back.
Humpback whales.
And now because they can use the GPS system, and so on, it is amazing when they look at the mass, and they, you are talking about from Brazil to the pole, and they, when he was like, and wow, the scientist was this, when he saw the maps, generated from the GPS about the path that these waves took, straight. And immediately I remember, وَمَا مِن دَابَّةٍ إِلَّا هُوَ آخِذٌ بِنَاصِيَةٍ. This is nasiya.
Certain for sure.
This is nasiya.
The brain?
The forehead. So each thing in this universe, in this existence, okay, is taken by the nasiya, by the forehead, if you like, okay?
a long a straight line, and it says Inna Rabbi ala siratin mustaqim, because Allah is taking, He is on the right path, and He is taking them. They will be on the right path, on the straight path. But when it comes to the human beings, it becomes a challenge.
And it's a challenge.
This is why we say every day, اهدنا صراط المستقيم. So the idea, the question every time when we are executing really our order, okay, where are we? We need all the time to be vigilant about the straight path that will take us into, because it is towards Allah, which means towards higher levels and altitudes towards Allah, because this is the journey that you want really to take. Otherwise, if we take another route, it will not take us into the higher levels. Yes, please.
I have a question. One or two statements. Allah made us will, choice to think, make decisions. The animals do not have that.
Mm-hmm.
Here's a question. So did He adapt them with a, you talk about neutrons. We all have like an electrical, some type of electrical charge or something in us. The earth has a gravity, sort of a magnetic pull. In the animals, is it a higher level in them, which gives them the ability to connect to that, which actually gives them their own GPS system?
Yes.
Did Allah give them
in
that?
In fact, that scientist was amazed that he could not find, like, it's not an even an internal compass. He said there should be something from outside. Wallahi, this is, you go and read the article.
I think there's something magnetic in their brain.
They think that, but his findings are beyond something internal. There is something coming from outside.
Yes. Take this, another example. Take the idea, there is butterfly.
Yeah,
that
yeah.
I think goes from Canada to Mexico.
From yeah. Canada, yes, to Mexico. That's
and,
through Chicago, by the way.
And they die through, yeah, you know, well, there's more than one generation.
Yeah.
So this is very, it's very powerful, because it means even death itself is not an excuse to not achieve the goal, when the goal is part of you, it's an order.
Yeah.
And this is very interesting at the human being level. So let's say, for example, someone is doing some research. It's good if you can put the purpose of your research. So even if you die, someone else, he can take it.
Beyond this.
Part of the design, yes.
That's good, that's good. Yeah, but because you are talking at the academic level, but...
No, we are. Even for inter or for 16-year-old we teach, there is always what they want to do.
I know, but this is we are talking about scientific research. But in daily life, we are not used to this.
Okay.
How to translate that?
When my father, I don't know anything about what my father want to do. This is a big issue, because this will help us. The idea of biography, the idea to write what you want to achieve.
Yeah,
it can be, you know, this day, because this is how you can make it part of daily life.
How to give the tools
become
to
the habit. This is why this is the same society turns in circles.
That's very surprising. Yeah. I don't know. I think we in Pakistan, the child is born, the father lost the world. What is his desire for that child, for his, what he could achieve? We have that amazingly.
But I think he's also talking about teaching them,
writing.
telling them what to do.
Culture.
It can be a
new culture that knows what they are. Their culture that is in continuous brain. Mm. They always are aware of space and time, but they know the Qibla. This is the prophecy. This is the prophethood. This is what is the prophethood. What I can see the project. This is why they were the first to achieve the goal or the purpose of human being in this life. Sidrat al-Muntaha, Qaba Qawsayn ya Adna. That where is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? That is in level that even Jibril cannot reach it. This means as human being, you know, the individual, but at the societal level also, if we take this as a way, as a method, you know, as a new paradigm to how to act in this life, it will help us to keep moving toward better.
Exactly.
Now, next week, inshallah, when we talk about the experience of Musa alayhi salam, let us keep that, okay, in the back, because it will be a very practical thing, okay, how we can learn. We don't want to repeat again. That's not here about a recurrence. I mean, like,
yes.
No, eternal recurrence. No, we don't want to do that. We want to look back to learn from that experience and see how we can shape our present and the future based on that. Thank you very much.
Speaking of, you know, going back animal religious and sound, there is one ayah, in the room, inside of the room, so far.
Yeah, the challenge. I mean, the difference.
The room for that justice.
Yeah, between the difference, as we were saying, if the other creatures are doing it by a direct order and they cannot, they have one direction.
Right.
For us, we have this dualism. We have the choice that we have, and this becomes a challenge for us. So we have to use our minds, our intellect, our reasoning to make a choice, but the right choice.
We have
and we learn from this experience because we see them when they are executing their, I mean, orders, they keep things in balance. You see what I mean? But for me, in order to be in harmony, I have to keep in harmony with them. So that I will really get the best of this life. Otherwise, there will be some disturbance and I will pay the price. However, it is in social life or in environment, as today we are seeing it, we are paying a bigger price because we did not pay attention to the environment in terms of its pollution. You see, and we are polluting. I mean, what are we leaving for the next generation?
It's
very polluted environment. You see what I mean? The same thing. Are we really handing to them a better society or society full of diseases, whether physical or social? Yes.